I know I have the, I'm Ben Jedlovec, I'm the next presenter here. I have the fortunate or unfortunate privilege to present after Bill James and then the StatCast panel. So thank you to those of you who have stuck around. And those of you who are here, I'm not entirely sure why you're here because there's cookies outside, but thanks anyways. So I am going to give a little bit of a philosophical talk today and try to answer some, you know, maybe along the lines of what Bill was talking about earlier, try to answer a couple of more or ask a few more macro level questions or closer to that side of things than some of the micro level presentations and research that I've been involved in and I've had the opportunity to present here in the past. And that's on the topic of statistics versus data science. And I hesitate to even use the word versus to pit them against each other because they're different approaches to the same sorts of questions and same sorts of problems. And they have a lot of similarities, but some differences. And I kind of want to walk through those a little bit here with the group and address those. So first of all, you know, what is statistics? Statistics has been around for a while. Everybody kind of understands what statistics is. It's an industry that's existed for centuries, really. You know, dating back to some early census work when people were trying to collect data on different governments and nations and states, and it goes back a few centuries. And I'll get into that a little bit. Versus data science. What is data science? It's more of it's a newer term. But really, both statisticians and data scientists, they're trying to answer the same questions. They're trying to use data and answer questions, draw conclusions, and learn more about a certain topic, right? And they've come out of very different contexts. Statistics has been around for a while. Data science has really come out of the new computer and technology age. But their perspectives, although they have very different perspectives and backgrounds, they really are trying to do the same thing. So I've got here a graph of, just to kind of give you a visualization of kind of the different perspectives. Statistics has been around for a while, and so these are job postings from Indeed.com graphed by over time, over the last about 10 years. There's about a 10-year interval here. So here in the blue is the statistics job postings, which has been pretty level over 10 years, and has generally been a pretty highly demanded job, in-demand job. But you can see data science didn't even really exist until about January 2011, and then it's just skyrocketed. And now there's way more jobs posted for data scientists than statisticians. But you know, really, they're kind of doing the same job, and they might be looking for slightly different skill sets, but they're being hired to do very similar sorts of work. So let me walk through statistics and data science in a little bit more detail on a few, in a kind of a compare contrast in a few different respects. Let's talk about kind of the background and the history of traditional statistics first. So like I said, this statistics has been around for centuries at this point. You know, notable statisticians, you know, are all dead now. They were born and lived during different eras, but they made significant contributions that we still rely on today in the world of statistics. You know, the general idea was, look, we can't possibly know all of everything about a whole population of people or data points. So let's try to do what we can with a smaller sample and then make inferences, right? We're going to make inference or draw inferences about a larger population or about a larger group or about the world or about life or whatever the topic that we're covering. Data science, on the other hand, of course, has emerged really the last 20 years, and you could draw this line wherever you want to draw it. The term data science really doesn't go back before about 20 years, but really it's grown with the advent of computers and databases, and as computers have progressed, data science has progressed, and really not even linearly, but exponentially. With the kind of problems that data scientists have been tasked with in the last couple of decades, 10, 20 years, sample size is not so much a problem anymore. We have Google tracking everything that we do, right? They're tracking us on our phones right now, exactly where we are, where our location is, and you know, they have all sorts of information about everything that's going on in the world, and so you know, sample size is not a problem. They're surveying almost the entire population at all times. And collecting data, and it's a little bit, you could argue that it's a little bit broader discipline than statistics, depending on exactly how you define it. but combined with the tech industry expansion, it's been rated by Glassdoor, for example, as the number one job over each of the last 2 years when they post the, you know, here are the top jobs, whatever that's supposed to mean. They look at the number of positions available, the job satisfaction ratings, and I assume they take some statistical survey to try to determine that. And then they factor in salary as well. So they've rated data scientists the number one job in at least the country over the last 2 years. So these are, you know, both of these jobs are very, very useful and growing in utility. So let's go through some examples. So traditional statistics, you know, maybe a very obvious and very baseline example in statistics is let's say you're a pharmaceutical company and you have a new drug and you're trying to, you know, cure cancer, or you're trying to at least reduce cancer incidence, right? You can't test that on the entire population of the world, right? It's both impractical and also risky, right? Like, what if your drug actually causes more cancer, then you just wiped out the entire world's population. So you have to test it on a smaller sample, and then we want to use that smaller sample to make inferences about how it will impact the whole population. We use statistics in social science. We use it in political polling. Here's from the more successful 2012 538 prediction of the presidential election. You know, sometimes statisticians are right and sometimes they're not right, but they also, one of the nice things about statistics is it comes with a certain degree of measurement of the uncertainty. And we can use that to make some inferences about likelihood of certain things happening based on our sample data. Data science, it's everywhere now. Machine learning and data science especially. If you've ever used a search engine, right, you've interacted with some data science, some machine learning. If you've ever posted a picture to Facebook, they're now scanning that and tagging you automatically and all of that just with facial recognition, just looking at photos. A great example of data science and machine learning in action, I got in town last Friday night and I was driving to the grocery store to pick up a couple of things, and there right next to me is an Uber self-driving car. I'm like, wow, this is pretty impressive. I don't get to see this very often. And although I guess Google is now suing Uber because they stole the technology or whatever, but the fact is it's running cars now. It's pretty impressive what data science has been able to accomplish in just 20 years for a field that, you know, 20 years ago didn't exist. So let's look at some pros and cons, some strengths and weaknesses of each of them. Statistics, you know, has strong theoretical underpinnings, right? So it's based in theory, based on centuries of research and theory, and really has a foundation in mathematics, right? In some cases, calculus and et cetera. It's designed to be able to succeed with a very limited amount of data, right? The whole point is we're going to take a subset of data, we're going to take a sample of data, and we're going to try to make an inference about a population or about a larger subset. We can measure and account for the uncertainty, and so these are you know, pretty good strengths. Obviously, it's been very successful for statisticians for a number of years. Weaknesses, some drawbacks in statistics. We have to make certain assumptions for our theories to work, right? We might have to, if we're taking a sample of data, we might have to make assumptions that we took a simple random sample or a stratified random sample. You know, there's different kinds of assumptions that we're making about our subset and our sample of data and about what it means for the population as a whole. We might have to make assumptions about independence of variables, which may not entirely be true. And so sometimes just by picking a model, you're immediately making your whole analysis technically not sound and not valid. From the minute you start on your, you know, building your model, but we kind of work with this, and you know, I was a statistics major in college myself, and this is something that you work with as a statistician, and you work around, and you work with that limitation. There's computational challenges to this too, right? Sometimes the models that we use in statistics are so complicated. I'm sure some of you in the room can share this experience where you set up a model to run, and you're like, okay, it's running, and then you check it back 5 minutes later, it's still running, and then you check back an hour later, it's still running. You let it go overnight, and it's still running. Sometimes these models are very computationally challenging to solve and to come up with a best fit equation or whatever the case may be. Sometimes it's not practical, depending on your computing resources. It's becoming more and more practical thanks to the the progress that computers have made. But statistics can also be very slow to develop. And it kind of ties in with the last bullet point on that column about whoever, the statistician, the practitioner, whoever's utilizing the model and using it to break down data, they need to be able to understand how the data is kind of constructed, kind of the nature of the data itself, or the relationship between the variables, and then be able to match that with the model that might best fit it. And there's ways that you can test this and find that it's working or not working, of course. But it's it can be a very challenging process for someone to work through, and not a very quick one. Data science, on the other hand, has strengths that are, in some case, opposite of statistics, right? So it has the opposite problem. Data science usually has been applied in cases where we have so much data we don't know what to do with it, right? It's the opposite kind of situation to statistics. And computer and data science was actually designed to take advantage of that fact, take advantage of the fact that we have a ton of data and we need to process it very quickly and learn about this data set. It can be simpler and faster to use, of course, if depending on what techniques you're choosing and how you're practicing it. That's one of the advantages of a lot of data science approaches. And it can be easier to model and kind of facilitate complex, especially nonlinear models and relationships. So the things that might take a statistical approach might take hours and hours and hours to run code or to run a program. You might find a data science approach that'll get you a very comparable answer or almost as good of as a perfect answer in far less amount of time, leveraging computer resources that we have these days. Weaknesses, and I say the term weaknesses here a little bit loosely, and these are really more like potential pitfalls and traps that data scientists can fall into if they're not careful. It's not always practiced in a theoretically sound way. And I'm not trying to overgeneralize about all data scientists in this way, but it can be very tempting and very easy for a data scientist, someone who has programming abilities and a large data set at their disposal, to put those two together, kind of throw a model that doesn't really make sense on top of the data and see what it spits out. And without investigating too closely, they end up with a model and they end up running with a model that actually doesn't make sense for the data at all and can be very dangerous. It's also easy with data science to sacrifice interpretability for accuracy. So you can fit a model to the data very easily with certain data science approaches and machine learning approaches. But that doesn't necessarily, depending on your purposes, you might not be able to learn that much about what the data set is telling you while you're doing that. So, you know, we'll walk through a couple of examples in a minute that might illustrate this a little bit better. It's also easy to fall into the trap of substituting more data for good data, right? When we have data, we it's very tempting sometimes to just assume it's all good and then run our models and then move forward. A good data scientist or a good statistician even will spend probably 80% of their time just cleaning up the data, understanding the data set itself and looking at the variables, what data is missing, et cetera, before they even start to analyze the data set. And that's not the sexy part, right? That's not the part that that they want to be doing. That's not the exciting part that's going to push them forward and bring great conclusions that they can take to their boss, but that is an important part, very important part, maybe the most important part. And a fourth one that I don't have on here is a danger of reinventing the wheel. And I'm gonna tell a story on here that just a week ago, I've started listening to some data science podcasts, and there's some good ones out there, and there's some not so great ones. I was listening to one last week. It was a 27-minute long episode on Stein's theorem, they called it, which is a thing in data science, and Stein's paradox. And well, they start describing it, and they actually start using a baseball example. And I'm into this. I get this. All right, let's see how this goes. So they're describing, and first of all, there's a co-host. There's a guy and a girl who host this podcast, and neither of them know anything about baseball. So they start off by talking about batting average. And they're arguing over what the definition of batting average is, and neither of them know what they're talking about. So it's immediately discouraging to me. It's not a good sign. They came up with, so you guys appreciate, their best conclusion, what is it, had something to do with times on base, but then you have to add home runs in, right? I'm like, you're making this a little bit more complicated than it really needs to be. It's supposed to be a simple example. You know, baseball is a great tool, as many of you have done, in fact, have used baseball to teach statistics. And they were butchering this whole effort. But so anyways, they took an example. They said, all right, well, let's say we have a player who we have a small sample of at-bats in the first half of the season. We want to project what he's going to do in the second half of the season. And they knew enough to like kind of know that 250 is like not an unreasonable batting average. So they're saying, all right, let's say that the average player has a 250 batting average, but this guy had 2 at-bats in the first half of the season, just to use an extreme example, all right? So let's say he goes 2 for 2 in the first half of the season. And they're trying to say, okay, well, how should we project what he's going to do in the second half of the season? So let me walk you through their thought process here. So they said, well, there's this formula, Stein's formula, where you can take the 2 at-bats and the 1,000 batting average in the first half of the season, and you can look at the league's average or the team's average, in fact. And they were really keen on the team's average for some reason that I didn't quite understand. But they said you could use the team's average, and let's say it's 250. And you could apply this formula, and depending on what constants you want to use in this formula, you'll weigh the 1,000 batting average a certain amount and the 250 batting average another amount. And I'm thinking to myself, like, do they realize they're describing regression to the mean in more complex and less theoretically sound terms? And I gave them 27 minutes to realize this, and they never got there. It was really disappointing. And basically, they were using a data science theorem that existed that was regression to the mean that I don't know when exactly it was invented, but where's Tom Tango? He could give, you know, he could probably tell you a little bit more about this. And would preach this, and it would probably be more frustrating to him than it is to me. Anyway, so there's a danger of reinventing the wheel. When you give programmers data and they don't necessarily have the statistics background here. So let me do a couple of examples quickly here. So first, let's do a simple linear regression. Let's take defensive runs saved in 1 year. This is, you know, some data from BIS, an easy example that I think will illustrate the point. Defensive runs saved in 1 year, and we'll use it to project defensive runs saved the next year. Simple enough, right? And so we say, all right, well, maybe we want to try to fit a linear curve here. Let's do a linear regression, and not a linear curve, a linear line, and we're going to fit it to this data, and we're going to have a line with an equation y equals ax plus b, and we're going to try to find the values for a and b that best fit the data and minimize the, in this case, squared errors, the squared error terms. Okay. So a statistician says, great, I know how to do this, right? There's a formula. I can solve this equation. I can plug in this data, and I can draw a line, and it's going to be perfect. Know how to solve this, simple, done. A data scientist will say, well, let me draw a line. Let me guess. Let me draw a line here. In fact, let's start with this one, this lighter one here. Let me draw that line and then test it and say, okay, That was okay, but let me try another one, see if I can do better. So they'll draw a second one, and they'll say, okay, well, this one's a little bit better, but I think there's more room to go here, so I'll draw another one. And the statistician, meanwhile, is looking over at him like, what are you doing? Like, why is this taking so long, right? But the data scientist is iterating here, right? And he's going to get closer and closer, and eventually he's going to get within a rounding error of the right answer, depending on how much time he wants to spend on this. And, you know, some parameters in his equation. Well, you might say, well, what's the point? Why do we need a data scientist when we have a statistician who can just solve it and give us the answer, right? Well, when we get to more complex models, it's not always that easy to solve it. And you might need a data scientist who can very quickly get you very, 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 very close to the best answer, as opposed to taking hours and hours and weeks to get you something that's exactly the right answer, or maybe you even made some assumptions that's not even the right answer anymore, that violate the assumptions that are violated right off the bat. So let me talk about defense again and use another example. With defensive metrics historically, we've taken what I'll loosely call a traditional statistics approach. We've taken a couple of different approaches to try to build defensive metrics. One of the most common, of course, is trying to bucket plays, similar types of plays together, and then use that sample of plays to draw conclusions about each of the individual plays in that bucket. And not every play is the same. There's slight differences between these plays, but overall, this has worked very well. This is the foundation for defensive runs saved and UZR and a lot of a lot of other defensive metrics. In fact, we have the creators of all of these metrics here in the room today, zone rating and UZR and DRS, which I think is fun. Anyway, so a lot of them based on a very similar and very effective concept of bucketing similar types of plays together and drawing conclusions about those individual plays and about the fielder who was involved in them. We can even take a more complex approach where you use similar data and you try to build more of a continuous function, maybe a logistic regression model or different things, and do a slightly more theoretical model that might fit the data a little bit better and takes a lot more effort potentially, and might improve your models a little bit. Shane Jensen's SAFE system was developed probably 12 years ago now at this point as one such example of this. And these are, you know, kind of traditional statistics approaches to this problem of evaluating defensive players. Now, if we give this to a data scientist, he's going to say, all right, I'm going to throw these inputs into a machine learning model, and I'm going to see what comes out. So you could train, say, a random forest model on this data set and have it predict whether a certain play is going to become an out or become a hit. We're just going to loosely group everything into hits and outs for the moment. And you could forecast, you know, the hit probability or the catch probability. And you could do this, right? You could do this with a machine learning model. So, in fact, we did this just for the sake of illustration for this presentation. We compared the plus-minus system, or what we call now the range and positioning system, to a gradient-boosted trees. It's essentially an enhanced version of a random forest machine learning model. We spent like all of a day building this, compared to literally years of work that have gone into something like the defensive run-save system. And the range and positioning system. We gave it the same inputs essentially as the range and positioning system, the plus minus system used, looking at the location of the batted ball, looking at the hang time or the velocity of the ground ball. We actually left out some of the situational variables that we take into account for infielders on ground balls in this particular case, just for simplicity. But we just gave it the batted ball characteristics, and then we were gonna test this side by side with the plus minus system. We're going to look at even and odd year correlations. So we'll say, all right, let's run these numbers for several years in a row, and we're going to look at the even years and the odd years and see how well those are correlated with each other, and that'll be an indication of how consistent this metric is. So we did this, and we went position by position. We found, first of all, in the top row here, that they were correlated with each other. Again, you know, some of the infield stuff is less correlated because we did not factor in the situational variables that the plus minus system does factor in, just for simplicity and time. Outfield, of course, very highly correlated using the same inputs, and that's roughly what we'd expect. I don't know that we would expect necessarily this high of a correlation, but it's very high. And then looking at the even odd correlations by position, we have the gradient boosted method right here, the gradient boosted trees versus the plus minus system. And we find very comparable, and in fact, in some cases, in the case of the outfield positions and shortstop, higher correlations with something we spent a day on as opposed to years of work. Now, this is not really a fair comparison because when we put this gradient boosted tree together, we obviously had the benefit of the years of work in our own heads, and so we knew kind of how to set this up from scratch. So it's not really fair for me to say years versus a day. But this is, generally speaking, true, where you can put data into a machine learning algorithm and get results very fast. You can't always interpret the results necessarily the same way. They might not be as predictive necessarily, but you can get very effective models taking advantage of computing power that we have today. So I kind of summarized some of these conclusions already, but the model itself correlated very well with existing plus minus, especially in the outfield. The even and odd years are comparable, in some cases better, in some cases worse at this point. And I explained how the infield doesn't, the plus minus system is actually factoring in some of the situational things that the gradient boosted trees method was not. So, of course, you know, we've seen examples where this, now one example with the linear regression where the statistics approach seemed like the better approach, the more straightforward approach and the more efficient approach. And we've seen another example where they seem to be getting in the same ballpark of the quality of answer. And so why don't we combine them? And you know, as is often the case when you have two competing ideas or two different numbers of a guy's defensive value, you know, usually the answer is somewhere in between or a combination of them, the most effective answer. So we can take the strengths of statistics and the strengths of data science, combine them together, and that's really where the sweet spot is. And so there's a very good Venn diagram that I wanted to spend a couple minutes on here in closing, to just walk you through, where we're kind of talking about the intersection of three skills or abilities here, where we have domain expertise. In this case, we're talking about baseball. So baseball knowledge and understanding, right? We have down here, we have mathematics or statistics. We're kind of grouping those together for this conversation. And then we have computer science skills in the green, programming ability, that sort of thing. And really, we have these interesting areas of overlap, right? So where we've lived as an industry before data science became a thing has been kind of this overlap between the blue and the yellow, the statistical research field. And that's what's been around for decades and centuries at this point. And that's how we've traditionally approached even sabermetric problems. I won't say that globally that everybody has taken the same approach, but that's been kind of the historical approach to doing analysis, right? Take a statistical approach. Well, then there's, let's go to the intersection of the blue and the green here between statistics and computer science, and we have what we could call kind of theoretical machine learning development, where you develop certain machine learning models that when applied to the right data, could be very effective and could combine the computer science benefits and the data processing abilities with the statistical understanding and theory to get the most effective models. And then we have an area here between the yellow and the green, which as a statistician, I kind of think of this as like a danger zone, right? This is when somebody knows a little bit about the data they're working with and they know enough how to manipulate the data with a programming language or statistical or some sort of software, they can move the data around. But it's a danger zone in the sense of this is exactly what's going on when I listen to a 27-minute podcast reinventing regression to the mean. It's when you put the data in hands of people who don't have the statistics background, they can find more effective solutions, but they can also either reinvent the wheel or go down paths that are often counterproductive or even very damaging, very dangerous. And the same is true with really any of these, right? So in the statistical research quadrant here or overlap, If you don't have programming ability and you aren't able to take advantage of modern computer techniques and methods and maybe machine learning models, you're going to take a lot longer to get to the same answer that someone who does have those skills is able to do. So really, you know, this is kind of the interesting sweet spot, the theoretically true data science, the sweet spot of data science, the intersection of all three of these skills. And I think there's a few interesting ramifications for that square, that section in particular. Obviously, we should be applying all three of these skills, and I'm kind of loosely talking about the statistics and the data science part specifically here, but obviously domain knowledge as well, whether it's baseball or medical or any other industry. This is increasingly more relevant in the StatCast era, right? We have a massive amount of data now, right? And what's the best way to process this data and learn about this data set and learn about baseball really better? Is it traditional statistical methods? Are there more effective techniques that maybe we need to get a little more creative and change how we think about tackling these problems? Maybe we need to go about it a little bit differently given we have a different data set now and we have more computing power on our side and more tools in our kit. Uninformed application in any of those regions can be dangerous, and this is especially relevant for all of you case competition members or participants. The demand for this triple skill set here, the data science skill set, is only going to grow, and this is not limited to just baseball. If you know how to analyze data with proper statistical and mathematical background, if you know how to manipulate data with a programming background, and you have some level of domain expertise, whatever domain that ends up being, that's the number one job in the world right now, right? That's the job that pays well and people are enjoying, you know, very satisfied with their job. That is where the money is. That's where the jobs are. I'm an adjunct professor at Lehigh as well, and I teach a course on sabermetrics, where Lehigh's actually built an entire program, an entire initiative at their whole university called Data X, which is really dedicated to data sciences, and they're trying to build kind of a cross departmental collaboration, a collaborative effort, where the computer scientists are talking to the math and statistics department, talking to the economics department, and collaborating and bridging the gaps with these skill sets, because they're realizing that combining these different skill sets that we've taught independently previously is not going to get us all the way there, right? There's an increasing demand for people in this area who have mastery of all of those skills, and the number of people who have mastery of all those skills is very, very few. It's very, very limited. And so if you're, you know, there was a question earlier on the GM panel about how to get a job in baseball, and it's something that I've done a lot of interviewing people, hiring people, talking to, you know, my students in my class. How do you get a job in baseball or in sports or really in any industry at this point? Well, this is the answer right here. As many of those skills as you can pick up, the more jobs there are going to be for you. So quickly, let me acknowledge Alex Vigderman, who is not here, but has contributed to this project this presentation more than anybody else, and was a tremendous asset and helped in preparing this. Thanks to my company, Baseball Info Solutions. Thanks to SABR for having me back. I think this is the fifth time in 6 years I've had the opportunity to present here, and it's been really wonderful. And thanks to you for your attention. So, any questions? Meredith. Uh-oh. Right. Right. I am probably not the most qualified person to answer that question, and I certainly didn't come up with the term. But I'm sorry. Yeah, it's right. 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 I mean, you hit on a couple of really great points, I think, where, you know, first of all, I think it's part science, but it's also part computer science, and it's part economics, and it's part statistics, and it's part math, and it's really a cross-department, you know, in terms of a university, but it crosses a lot of different fields and is very relevant to many different fields in pretty much every industry at this point. Absolutely, and you know, kind of the analytical approach that scientists take is you know, it's in that math area really, and also the domain expertise area for sure, and then the other point about, you know, getting back to what Bill said before of like, you know, there is a danger, and I think that there are people who fall into this trap of, hey, we have data, now what do we want to do with it, instead of like Bill emphasized and you're pointing out, you know, you got to start with a question. Right, you can't just start exploring the data, and then, or you might wind. It's very dangerous. You might end up down the wrong path, or a non-productive path, or doing more micro level work, micro sabermetrics maybe, as opposed to macro sabermetrics. So, so that's, yes, I should have emphasized that much stronger for sure. But any other questions? Okay, thank you for your time.